Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our presentation tonight on an introduction to options. My name is Graham O'Brien. I'm from the ASX and I'm going to spend about the next hour introducing you to options, or at least giving those of you that are already trading options a refresher of some of the basics that you really need to understand before you start trading in the options market. Myself, I've been in the market for over 20 years now, and I'm going to share some of my experience with you over that 20 years of how I learnt about options, but most importantly, giving you an opportunity to be able to ask questions of me here this evening. We've got a slide pack to go through, but I'm more than happy to pause at any stage for you to be able to ask questions of me, whether it be about introduction to options or anything to do with the options market whatsoever. The way you can do that is via the Q&A section within the Zoom app. Simply put the question through to all of me, to all of the panelists, and that's basically me this evening. I'm more than happy to answer some of those questions for you here this evening. As for recording, we are recording this session as well. So those of you that are dialed in and listening to the recording, if you are wanting to ask questions from the recording session, simply send your questions through to options@asx.com.au. And I'm more than happy to answer those over email as well. So let's kick off things. And as I said, feel free to ask questions at any stage during tonight's live presentation. Before we do get started, I do have to advise everyone that this particular session itself is for educational purposes only, not to be used as financial advice. Importantly, if you are wanting financial advice when it comes to the options market, advisors do need to be accredited. The Australian Securities and Investment Commission do require derivatives advisors and options advisors to be accredited before they can give you advice. So make sure you ask them for their accreditation if someone is giving you advice around any trading strategy when it comes to the options market. What are we going to cover here this evening? We're going to, obviously, as an introduction to option, talk about what options are. Now we're going to look at what these things are, calls versus puts. We're going to look at single stock options, index options. There are options that are expire every single week. And I thought important when you're starting out in options anyway, one of those complicated topics is around options pricing. We're going to touch on some of those basics, then what you might want to do next steps. And there's lots of valuable resources on the ASX website, and touch on some of our upcoming masterclasses that you may want to progress to, or at least look at the recordings of past sessions themselves. So what are options? I know when I was at university, I studied a course that introduced me to options, and I thought, wow, this is a complicated topic. There's no way I'm ever going to get involved in an options market because it just seems too complicated to me. And I think the major reason when I was at university anyway is they throw out this definition that we have on the screen at the moment. I'm going to quickly read it. It's a contract between two parties that conveys a right, but not an obligation, to buy a call or sell off to put an underlying security at a specified price within a specified time frame for an agreed premium. It's a real mouthful. And I found the best way for me to learn and start understanding what options really are is through the use of analogies. And I'm going to quickly share an analogy with you that I hope will help you start understanding what actually makes up an options contract. The analogy I like to use is a housing analogy. I know 25 years ago when I was looking to buy my first house, I always thought I had enough of a deposit saved up to buy the house that I really liked. But the housing market just kept on running away from me. I would have loved at that time to walk down to my neighbor. I really like their house, and knock on their door and say, look, I want to buy your house, but I'm not going to be able to save up enough money for 2 years' time. Can I buy your house for $500,000 in 2 years' time for if I agree to pay you $25,000 today? My neighbor probably slams the door in my face and says, walk away. Why would I ever agree to that? Housing markets apparently only ever go up, but let's say they agreed to my contracts and they agreed that they would sell their house to me for $500,000 in 2 years' time if I paid them $25,000 today. If we entered into this contract, we would have actually just entered into an options contract, me and my neighbor. First of all, that highlight in blue, I want to buy my neighbor's house, so I'd be buying a call option in this particular case. The underlying security is my neighbor's house. The specified price at which I'm agreeing to pay in the future is $500,000. The time frame, 2 years. That's when I reckon I'm going to have enough of a deposit saved up. And the agreed premium I pay up front is $25,000. This idea of conveying a right but not an obligation comes over the life of the option. So let's say we jump 2 years down the track. That house of my neighbor's is now worth $700,000. I would exercise my right to buy the neighbor's house for $500,000. And all it cost me was the $25,000 up front. So effectively, I'm buying a $700,000 house for an all-in cost of $525,000. This right but not the obligation works in my favor if the housing market actually fell. So if the housing market fell, and rather than it going up from $500,000, it fell to $300,000, I would walk away from my right because I have a right but not an obligation to buy my neighbor's house at $500,000. Instead, I'll just buy the house at the open market at $300,000. Once again, all it cost me was that $25,000 up front. So options, when we're buying them, they convey rights to us as purchasers of those options, but sellers have obligations. And we're going to come back to that when we look at the different styles of options that we can trade. But when we're buying options and buying call options, we have the right to buy something in the future. And we'll come to puts in a moment or two's time. Importantly, though, on the ASX, we don't obviously trade options over houses. We trade options over shares, ETFs, and the index. And there's a quick list here of all of the different stocks that we have options available. So 89 different single stocks on the ASX market, one exchange traded fund, which is the STW or the S&P ASX 200 ETF, and XJO, which is also over that same index, the S&P ASX 200 index. There's some really good questions coming through. I'm going to answer a number of those towards the back end. They're more in regards to options trading for those that are already trading. If you're not catching on to some of the topics we're going through at the moment, please feel free to ask those questions at any particular point in time, and I'm happy to pause at any stage. So let's have a look at these different components of share options. So we've kind of used this analogy of housing, but we have to start getting shares in our mind when we're trading options on the share market. So rather than a house, which is the underlying security, we're now talking stocks or indices. So Fortescue, Commonwealth Bank, BHP, CSL, or as I said before, that S&P ASX 200 index, which would be XJO. We always have expiration dates. So in my housing analogy, that had a 2 year expiration date. Options can have expiration dates that are expiring this week, next week, 1 month, 2 months, all the way out 3 years in time are the available expiry dates that you can purchase and sell options on the ASX itself. The strike price is the price at which you're going to be buying or selling that share in the future. So if it was a $20 stock, your strike price, for instance, could be $20. The premium is what you pay up front for the option. So you don't pay the strike price up front. The premium is what you see on your broker screen, which is what that option's price is worth. And we'll come back to that towards the end of tonight's session, of looking at some of the basics behind options pricing. There's always two types, calls and puts. We've looked at calls on the equation first. I'm going to touch on puts now as well. So in my housing analogy, I had the right, but not the obligation to buy my neighbor's house in the future. If the market went up, I exercised my right. If the market goes down, I let that right expire, because who would be crazy enough to buy something that was worth that I had to pay more than what it was worth? Puts, on the other hand, give us the right, but not the obligation to sell something in the future. And I always think of puts as insurance. So I have the right, but not the obligation to sell my shares at any price that I like in the future at that strike price, for instance. So I think of it as car insurance. One of the first things that you're going to agree with the insurance company around your car is the agreed value of that car. If you drive down the road later that afternoon and your insurance policy is in place, then the insurance company is going to have to cut you a check for the agreed value of your car. What do I have to pay up front in this insurance contract is the insurance premium that I pay up front to my insurance company. In the share market, when it comes to put options, I pay a premium up front. I have an agreed value at which I can sell my shares, But if those shares go bankrupt, someone's going to be cutting me a check for the agreed value or what I was actually as what I was actually wanted to sell those shares in the future. So when I buy a put option, I have the right to sell something in the future. We'll get to another analogy. I really like them. If I'm thinking about what I want the market to do, whether it's a call or a put, I always think of calling someone. I'm always calling someone up on the phone. I'm putting the phone up to my ear. So when I'm buying call options, you want the market to go up. You're calling someone up. Put options, on the other hand, think about putting your cup of coffee down or your glass of water down on the table. If you're buying put options, you actually want markets to go down. So calls up, puts down when we're purchasers of those particular contracts themselves. I have a really good question that's popped through in regards to the analogy that I used around that $25,000 analogy that I had to pay up front for the right to purchase my neighbor's house. Is that non-refundable? And does it come on top of the house price? So just the same way as you buy and sell shares, the premium that you pay up front, if you hold that premium all the way through till its expiry date, that premium has been used over that period of time. However, you have the right to be able to sell that premium over time. And it's a really good time to ask that question because the option holder and the holder of that long position has the right to purchase, sell the instrument at that specified price, that specified time frame, but they pay that premium up front. But over the life of the option itself, they can actually go and sell that option to someone else. So if the housing market went up and I no longer wanted to buy my neighbor's house, but I found someone else that wanted to buy my neighbor's house, I might be able to sell them my option, which I originally purchased for $25,000 for a higher price. So I could be able to sell it to them for $40,000 or $50,000. That's where the open market nature of options markets work, is people can just buy and sell options. They don't actually need to hold or trade the underlying shares as well. So whilst it sounds like it's this non-refundable nature, over the life of the option, I can actually sell it, and you can sell it for profit if the market moves in your favor. If the market moves against you, then obviously you may be selling it at a loss, just the same way as when you buy a share, the share can go up, you make a profit, the share can go down, you make a loss. If, however, you hold on to that option all the way through from the day you purchased it, all the way through to the expiry date itself, now you have choices on what you want to do with that stock. So you can exercise your right. If you bought a $20 strike price option as a call, and that share price is now worth $30, you would exercise your right, buy the shares at $20 because the prevailing market is now $30 on those shares. However, you do have the right to let it expire where that option is what we call out of the money. So let's say that stock had fallen to $15. You're not going to be paying $20 for a stock that is now worth $15. So you would let that option expire worthless. And if you still want to buy the shares, you just buy them in the open market. But in that case, you've foregone the premium that you paid up front in that particular case. Put options, we want the opposite to occur. So we can sell that put option, but they're only going to be profitable for us as a person who purchased that put option if the market had fallen. Remember that analogy, calls, put phones up to our ear, we want markets to go up. Puts, you want market to go down. So for you to profit off a put as a result of a movement in a share price, the share price will have had to have fallen at that particular case. Just pause for a moment and have a look at a few extra questions that come through. A really good question from T in regards to early exercise of call options. How do we work out if a counterparty is going to exercise early? Generally, T, that is going to occur on the last come dividend date for a stock. So obviously we have the right to do something as buyers of options over the life of that option. If someone is actually going to exercise, it's generally on the last come dividend date. And we actually have a calculator on the ASX website that's going to help you in understanding when most people actually do that exercise. So definitely something that that we'll touch on when we get further down into the question time. Someone's asked a question around dividends and call options. I might come back to that when we come to pricing, because I'm going to touch on that in the pricing stage. Can we buy call and put options at the same time? Is there benefit of doing it? If you think the market's becoming very volatile, you just don't know which way the market will move. You just think it's going to move up or down. If you purchase both a call and a put, if the market goes up a lot or goes down a lot, you can still benefit from that particular trade. If there are fears of recession, would people be more willing to make put options? Definitely, if there's a fear of a recession and you think share prices are going to fall, then people may look to buy put options to protect themselves against a fall in the market. Exactly the reason why people use puts to protect themselves against falls in share markets themselves. Is there a minimum amount to purchase options? We're going to come back to that, but there are contract sizes themselves. Really good questions. Keep them on coming through. So I've touched on the buyer side of the equation, but in all markets, we obviously need buyers and sellers to meet for transactions and contracts to be determined. In my housing analogy, my neighbor was the seller of that call option to me who wanted to buy their house. So the potential obligation to sell their asset sits on the call seller. The potential obligation to buy something in the future sits on the put seller. Think of them as the insurance company. If I write off my car, they're the ones that have to cut me a check for the agreed value of my car. If the company goes bankrupt, someone's going to have to cut you a check for the agreed value of what you agreed that you would be able to sell those shares for, even if the company falls to zero. The key difference between a seller and a buyer, however, is the seller has a potential obligation. Once we get through to expiry date, there's no rights on sellers anymore. They're obligated to fulfill whatever the seller of that, whatever the buyer of that option wanted at that point in time. So in my housing analogy, we got 2 years down the track. My neighbor had no choice. They had to sell me their house at $500,000, even though it's gone up to $700,000. So there is a lot of risk involved in selling options, especially if you don't own the asset. And we'll come back to that. Similar to buyers, the option sellers also get to determine what their strike price is of their option. So they're going to agree, and my neighbor would definitely want to agree on the price at which they would be happy to sell their house. As a seller of a call option over a share, you want to agree the value at where you'd be comfortable to sell those shares. Are you going to have a time frame of which you're going to be obligated for? Sellers of options tend to want to shorten that time frame up, because who knows what's going to happen tomorrow in the share market, let alone what's going to be happening in a year's time. But why do people sell options? They want that premium. Insurance companies offer insurance to us because they want to receive insurance premiums from us. Sellers of options want to earn income streams from the options market. Really good questions around capital gains tax doesn't apply to options. Obviously, you get that 50% discount on capital gains tax if you hold them longer than 12 months. Doesn't matter for the options market. That's a share market component. And do I need a broker to trade options? Most definitely. So I would always suggest the same broker you're using to trade shares, you should be selecting as your options broker as well, because it will help you in being able to see your share positions and your option positions all with the one broker. Once an option seller has sold an option, they don't have a choice anymore. They're obligated to do whatever the market wants. Over the life of the option, if they no longer want to be obligated, they can simply buy that option back. If they buy the option back, they pass on that obligation to someone else. Once it gets to expiry, they either have to let the option expire because the options buyer didn't exercise their right, or be assigned to fulfill their obligation. So if I'm a seller of a call, I have to sell my stock. If I'm a seller of a put, I have to buy that stock, no matter how far that stock price may have fallen. A couple of people are asking whether we're going to get into specifics tonight. This session is definitely around introduction to options. It's all around the basics of options. We have lots of recordings on the ASX website that goes into a lot of detail around the specific strategies themselves. But tonight's session was definitely an introduction to help people get on their journey that we'll be doing in future options masterclasses. So definitely around basics here this evening. So if it's sounding a little bit basic for you, feel free to jump off, have a look at some of the other recordings, but we're definitely just covering the basics here this evening. Another question, can you trade options online? Yes, most definitely. You can trade them online via your online broker. So if your broker offers equities online or shares online, you'll most likely find that they offer options trading online as well. So just to recap that summary of what buyers and sellers of options do. And if you're going to take one thing away from tonight, take this particular slide to be able to understand what your rights are versus obligations when you're trading options. Buyers of call options have the right, but not the obligation to buy. You're buying a call, you're calling someone up, you want markets to go up. Buyers of put options have the right, but not the obligation to sell something in the future. You're putting your coffee mug down on the table, you want markets to go down when you're buying put options. Sellers of options have obligations. A seller of a call option has the obligation to sell, or the potential obligation to sell, and the seller of a put option has the potential obligation to buy. If you are selling a call option and you do not own the stock, that is the most riskiest strategy that you can do in the options market and really in the share market altogether. Because if you don't own the shares, there's no limit as to how high a share price can go. If you don't own those shares and you're obligated to deliver them to someone else, you're going to have to go to the prevailing market, go and buy those shares, and it could be a significant loss, much, much higher, multiples of what you actually received in your original income. So understanding your risks in options markets are really, really important. I would only ever start out trading options as a seller if I already own those shares, because you can simply just deliver those shares. So my neighbor wouldn't have been able to sell the right to obviously buy their house from them in the future if they didn't own that house. So really important, if you're going to sell call options, only do it on stock you own. Don't do it on stock that you don't own. Another couple of good questions that are coming through. Options, are they really only on the major companies? Yes, most definitely. They're really over the top 90 stocks in the market. We don't have them over micro caps. We really want the liquidity there for the market itself. Bruce just wants me to quickly run through an example of a put option again. So I always think of it as insurance. So when you're buying insurance on your car, you ring your insurance company up. First thing you're going to agree is the agreed value of your car itself. And you're going to agree to pay that premium for that car and the time frame of which that insurance policy is going to last for. So let's say we buy a car and we have an agreed value of $30,000. That would be our exercise price or our strike price for that car. We pay a premium up front. Let's say it's a $1,000 insurance premium, and we're insured on that car all the way over the next year because that insurance policy lasts a year. If we go down the road, that car gets written off, then all of a sudden, we would then be able to obviously claim on that insurance from our insurance company. They're going to cut us a check for the agreed value of the car, which was that $30,000. And obviously we no longer have a car. When it comes to share markets, you might have a share that you own in your portfolio, but you're worried that it's going to fall. So you are going to insure that share for say $20. You're going to pay a premium upfront to the options market. Let's say that's $1. That's going to protect yourself if that share falls in value. If over the life of your option, let's say it was a one-year option, that company fell to $10, you would exercise your right, sell your shares at $20, and all it cost you was the premium that you paid up front. So the put option can help in being able to protect you against potential falls in the market. It can be also used just because you think the market's going down. You can buy a put option, hopefully see the market fall, and profit because the premium of that option is going to go up in value as the market falls. Hopefully that helped, Bruce. So let's touch on these options that we have on ASX themselves. Single stock options first. So as I said, they're over about the top 89 stocks in our market, but they have contract sizes. It's not like shares where you can just trade one share at a time. When it comes to options market, at least for single stock options, they always start out at 100 shares per contract. So before you start protecting your shares or wanting to buy a call option to see the share price increase, it's going to be in 100 share lots. So one options contract equals 100 shares. When I spoke about expiry dates, and I think in my example, I used March or April, the date in March or April that corresponds to is generally the third Thursday of the month, but your brokers will have those expiry dates listed all on their screen. We have two types of options in the options market. They're called American style options and European style options. And all that tells us is an American style option, as a buyer of an option, we have the right to exercise on any day we want, from the day we purchase that option all the way through to its expiry date. And that will help us if we want to pick up dividends on a share, because options don't include dividends. You don't get paid a dividend just because you own an option. You have to own the shares. So someone might want to exercise early to be able to pick up dividends. European style options, on the other hand, the only day you can exercise is on the expiry date itself. You have no choice to do that early. What I mean by physically settled is that at expiry, it's the physical shares that are transferring between buyers and sellers. So 100 shares per options contract will transfer from obviously the seller through to the buyer. Just an example of how that American style option would work. So you can see all of those trading days are an opportunity to be able to exercise, even including the expiry date. However, when we get to European style options, the only day that you can actually exercise is on the expiry date itself. And your broker screens will tell you what is an American versus an European style option as well. Index options. Index options, a little bit different to share options. So they're over an index as opposed to an individual share. So we need to have a little bit of a different understanding of index options. And really, these are the most important, traded options now in the options market, because people often have views on the whole market as opposed to individual shares, or they might be protecting entire portfolios. So they buy put options over the index itself. Unlike share options, index options are what we call cash settled. It would be quite mean of us at ASX to say to you, look, you own that index option. Now you have to deliver 200 different shares in this ratio through to the buyer of that option. That just wouldn't work. So they're cash settled. No physical shares transfer hands in index options. It's dollars per point. And it's $10 for each tick of the index. So I think the index was around that 7,400 point tonight. So about $74,000 would be the value of that particular options contract. They expire on the same day, but not on the closing prices, on the opening prices of the market itself. And they're always European in style, just slightly different trading hours, but it's generally all of these contracts trade during normal share hours. That's where you're going to do most of your trading in both single stock and index options. Weekly options. There are also options that expire every single week. They're not over every single stock in the market, but the most liquid of our stocks have options that are available for you to trade a more fine art view. So if you think a stock is going to move much quicker within a week, you can potentially trade those types of options for the options market as well. I want to leave lots of time for questions at the end of tonight's session. So we're going to move on to options pricing. Before I do that, I'm just going to have a quick look at some of the questions that have rolled through. Some we're going to answer a little bit later. One of the things is, can a buyer of a put option wait without holding shares? If price has gone down significantly, they could buy it at a very low price and sell for a profit, exercising their option. Most definitely, Basant, with a put option, you might be able to just buy that put option as the market's fallen, be able to sell it back to the options market and take a profit from that transaction itself. You don't necessarily have to exercise your right on that option. You can just simply sell it back into the options market and take the profit there. John noticed that there's some options have very little liquidity. Buying some options can't sell them for a reasonable price. Our market maker's obligated to sell at a reasonable price. What I would suggest, John, is market makers are definitely obligated in the options market. But with all capital markets, the market sets the price at where buying and selling is going to be occurring at. But what we do at ASX is obligate the market makers to put both a buy and a sell price in those particular options. And we limit the spread in between what those buy and sell prices can be. So they can't skew it too far one way, because then obviously if they've skewed it on the upside, someone's obviously going to sell them to their bid price. So quite often the spread that you actually see on screen will be what determines it. What I would suggest though is always asking a quote request via your broker before transacting in the options market. And we did a session, I think in November, around market makers and how they trade in the market. indefinitely via your broker before entering into an options market. Always ask a quote request, because you often find that those spreads or the difference between the buy and sell price will always tighten up in the options market. So I'd always suggest ask those quote requests before trading in any options market. So pricing is really important for us to understand when we're starting out in options markets as well. And the reason being is that they're just priced different to shares. We're kind of getting used to share markets and you're used to share prices, but options just move so different to the way that share prices can move. So we're going to touch on some of those key pricing factors that influence an options price. So what I've got here is an example of a call option. And we've got a share price that is $4. And an option exercise price of $3.50. And the first two components that make up an options price are what we call intrinsic value and time value. Intrinsic value is what that option is worth if we were to exercise it at that very point in time. So this $3.50 strike option, where the shares are trading at $4, if we exercised our right to buy at $3.50, we would be making 50 cents automatically on that trade. So we buy at $3.50, we can sell in the prevailing share market at $4, you've made 50 cents. Simply the difference between the share price and the exercise price. But that isn't all you pay in an option. This option could be worth 72 cents in value, because there's also time value that's embedded in the option itself. First of all, there's time till expiry. The longer the time until expiry, the more expensive an option is going to be. If this was a call option and that company paid a dividend over the life of the option, or is expected to pay a dividend over the life of the option, then all else being equal, we expect a share to fall by the value of its dividend. People in the options market know that, and they know, as a call option buyer, why would I pay the full price for that option, not taking into account the dividend, when I'm expecting this stock to fall by that value on its ex-dividend date? So call options will be discounted by the value of the dividends that are expected to be paid in the future. So call options are cheaper as a result of dividends. Interest rates impact on options pricing as well. Both calls and puts are impacted by interest rates. How volatile the underlying share prices will impact on how much we're going to have to pay in time value. The more volatile a stock, the higher the options premium is going to be, regardless of whether it's a call or a put. The lower the volatility, the cheaper the option will be. And at all times, just like all markets, supply and demand will impact on pricing. So the two things that make up that intrinsic value are the price of the underlying and the strike price. And the things that make it take into account that time value is the time until expiry, the cost of money, taking into account interest rates and dividends, and the volatility of the underlying, will basically give us the price or the theoretical price of that option itself. So in this case, this $3.50 strike option, when the stock's trading at $4.72, is what we're going to have to pay up front for that option itself. We always use terms, or you'll hear your brokers use terms in the options market, in, at, and out of the money. And all it's telling you is whether that money, that option, has intrinsic value or no intrinsic value at all. We used that $3.50 strike option before. Stock trading at $4, that was in the money by 50 cents. If we had a $3 call option, it's $1 in the money, it's further in the money. The at the money option is the strike price closest to where the share price is. So a $4 strike option, $4 share price would be what we call the at the money option. And out of the money options actually need the stock to move before we would actually exercise our right. So a $4.50 call option, we need the stock to rally by 50 cents or more before we're going to exercise our right. A $5 call option, we need it to move by more than a dollar before we're going to exercise our right. So in, at, and out of money, often terms you're going to hear from brokers or even from journalists or commentators in the options market itself. It wouldn't be an intro to options lesson, I don't think, without talking some of the Greeks. Theta, time, theta. It's all about how much decay each day is going to occur to my option. So if all else were equal, we just move one day closer to expiry, how much value would my option lose over that particular time if I was the buyer? And why we have to understand that is it accelerates as expiry approaches. So when I start thinking about theta, over the first half of an option's life, you're going to lose one third of that time value of that option. over the second half of the option's life, you're going to lose two-thirds. It accelerates as expiry approaches. The only way we can affect that as options buyers is if we buy longer dated options, you're going to remain in the first half of the option's life for longer. So it's going to be decaying at a lesser rate, at least at the early stages of our of the life of that option. As options sellers, there are people that sell options out in the options market. They're going to want to jump into the second half of the option's life much quicker because it's going to benefit them. They want the option to fall in value as a seller. So in that case, they're going to sell shorter dated options, which allows the option or the options contract to move into its second half of its life much, much quicker. Paul's asked a really good question. Is the options price the same as the option premium price? Exactly the same thing, Paul. The options price is what we call premium. We often use interchanging terms when it comes to options market, but the premium is the options price that you see on screen via your options broker. Question that's come through, any suggestions for beginners, any demo accounts, brokers? I would always look to the same broker first that you're trading your shares with. A demo account, we're actually going to be starting up what will be an options game in the coming months. So keep an eye out for that. If you're wanting to use a demo account, you can effectively use that as part of an options game, same way we run the share market game. So if I start thinking about all those variables and the impacts that can be had on an options price, when we're thinking about calls, remember calling someone up, when a stock price goes up, that benefits you. You want the market to go up, calls are going to go up in value. Puts, on the other hand, if the stock price went up, remember putting something down on the table, that's negative to us. It's actually going to be a decline in put price for our stock price increase. Longer the time until expiry, all options are going to go up in value. Increase in volatility, so a stock becomes more volatile, all options are going to be more expensive. An increase in interest rates, it's going to increase the call option price but decrease the put price. We're flip side when it comes to dividends. If there's an increase in dividends, the call will go down in value, where the puts will go up in value because the market's expecting the stock to fall by more as a result of that dividend. Just check on a few of these questions. Does ASX have options tool like payoff diagrams, calculators, etc.? We definitely have a calculator, John. Before we finish up, I'll actually go to the ASX website and show you where you can find that calculator. There's actually a good tool, which is a Hoadley tool. That's a really good one when it comes to payoff diagrams. So Hoadley, just search that. It's a free tool. It actually has an Excel add-in. It's actually quite a good tool. David's asked, do options prices have an effect back on the underlying share price? They can at times, David. What will often happen is market makers will hedge when they're trading against people in the marketplace. But let's say there's a whole bunch of put buyers in the marketplace itself. It can impact because the risk to the market is hedging, is they might have to sell some shares to protect themselves against a further fall in the market. If you walk away from your right to buy a call, would you lose the premium? Yes, if you walk away at expiry, you most definitely lose the premium as a buyer. But over the life of the option, you have the right to sell it to someone else. So if you sell it before expiry, you can obviously try and recoup some of those costs back. And what type of taxes do I pay if I gain from options? You pay the same tax as though you would for buying and selling shares. If you profit from buying shares, then you're going to have capital gains tax for those shares. The difference with options, though, is if you hold the option for greater than 12 months, you don't get that 50% concession. But to be honest, most options transactions are only bought and held for within 3-month periods. You don't see many options being transacted greater than 12 months. Why interest go up for calls? Think about it. You're effectively borrowing money, Adam, when you're buying a call option. So we know when interest rates go up and you've borrowed money, then the cost to you is going to go up. So call prices are going to go up when interest rates go up. Can we buy options in a self-managed super fund for David? Yes, we actually have some information on the ASX website that should help you in seeing the strategies you can use in a self-managed super fund. If your option is in the money, is it automatically exercised as a buyer? That is the case. That option will automatically be exercised. If you bought a put, it would automatically sell those shares for you. If you had bought a call, then you'll be purchasing those shares automatically. If you want to get away from that obligation, simply sell the option back to the options market. What effect margin call would have on option trading? The strategies that we haven't really touched on strategy. If you're a buyer of an option, there is no margin call. You pay the premium up front. That's all you're obligated to obviously pay, similar to a share. If you're the seller of an option, I would only ever suggest selling call options to start, and stock that you own. You can actually lodge the stock that you own as collateral, so you don't have a margin call on that case either. Thanks. Really good questions coming through. Options delta. Options don't move dollar for dollar and cent for cent with underlying shares. And this can be really difficult for people that are starting out in options market. Is I bought that call option, the stock went up by a dollar. Why didn't my option go up by a dollar as well? And the delta helps us in understanding how much an option is actually going to move compared to a corresponding movement in the underlying share price itself. I'm going to quickly touch on an example. I think it's the easiest way. Out of the money options. So those options that we need the share price to move before we would exercise our right tend towards a delta of zero. The further out of the money the option is, the less it's going to move like a share price. So if a delta of an out of the money call option was 0.2, that option would only move 20 cents for every $1 movement in the underlying share price, because the market knows that the share price has to move before you're going to get a benefit at expiry from that option. If you trade an at the money option, it's 50-50 as to whether the market will go up or down if we bought a $4 strike price option when the shares were trading at $4. So it will move 50 cents for every $1 movement in the share price itself. Whereas in the money options, we'll start looking a little bit more like stock. In this case, we're using a 0.8 delta. It would move 80 cents in the dollar. There are options that are deep in the money that will move one for one with share prices. Another trick that delta tells us, and it's a good trick for people who are beginning. You can see here, I've actually adjusted some of these charts on the side here. A 0.1 delta is saying that that option has only a 10% chance, or the options market is telling us it has a 10% chance of finishing in the money at expiry. Stock has to move a long, long way before you are going to exercise your right. It's only a 10% chance. And at the money option, it's 50-50, 50% up, 50% down, whether the market will go up or down. Where an in the money option, 0.8, 80% chance if it had a delta of 0.8, that would be in the money at expiry. Just because an option is cheap doesn't mean it's good value, because the market is predicting that it is not going to be in the money at expiry. That's something that delta helps tell you, is the predictability or the of whether that option will finish in the money at expiry. Going to quickly head across to the ASX website and just show you some of those pages that a few people had asked some questions on. Someone's asked, can you explain about the ASX 200 options? So those were those index options, Mahesh, that we touched on before. So the options over the 200 index itself. So as those options will move up or down depending on the movement in the index as opposed to individual shares. So if the index is at 7,400 points and we bought a call option with a 7,400 strike, the index went up in value, those call options would move up in value as well. But remember, index options, you're not buying and selling shares, it's cash, and it's at $10 per point. So if you buy an option at 20 points, that would be worth $200 to buy one options contract in that ASX 200 option. And all you're wanting is the market to move up overall or down, depending on where that S&P ASX 200 index moves. Can you explain that automatic buy sell again? That's at expiry, Eric. So at expiry, if your option is in the money, the system at ASX automatically determines that option should be exercised because it's in the money and you'll be making money as a result of exercising that option. So let's say it was a put option, and you had a $20 strike price on that put option and the stock was only trading at $10. You would obviously want to sell your shares at $20 when the shares are currently trading at $10. So the market automatically exercises those options. You have sold your shares, and I'm expecting that you would own those shares at that particular case, and they're sold to the marketplace itself. Similarly, if it was a call option, $20 strike call option, if the stock was trading at $30, the market would automatically exercise that option at expiry. You would buy those shares at $20 when they're currently trading at $30. So it's just a mechanism that helps people in not losing money at expiry if there's intrinsic value embedded in those options. Give a numerical example of the use of theta as you did for delta. Let's say we had a theta of 0.5. What it's telling me is that option will lose half a cent from each day to next. If it has a theta of 0.5, it has a zero. If it has a theta of 2, it's going to lose 2 cents in the value of that option over that period of time. That's the easiest way to think of theta, is how many cents am I going to lose for each day movement in the option itself. Let's go to the ASX website. Some really good questions coming through. Just let me stop sharing. And I'll bring up our website. Okay, hopefully everyone can see the ASX website now. I'm just waiting to see the scan. Yep, seems like it's popped up for everyone now. This would be where you're coming to the ASX website itself. And if you want to have information when it comes to the options market, there's a number of different places that you can go. But I would always, as a new investor to any product on ASX, always go over to the investors section over here on the right-hand side here. Because this is where we have all of the resources and education material when it comes to all of the different products that are available for you on ASX. So there's online courses where it comes to shares or options or anything like that. There's a whole bunch of pages that take you to investing in shares, whether exchange traded products like ETFs, whether it comes to hybrids, bonds, or options. We actually have an options knowledge hub, which links you to all of the really key components of tools that will help you when it comes to options markets themselves. So many of you would have registered for the tonight's webinar, for instance, via this page itself. As we have new masterclasses coming up, we'll place them on this screen and you're able to then quickly be able to register via this page as well. Any of our previous webinars where it comes to options pricing, or we've done other strategies, whether it's buying puts for protection or writing calls for income, collars, spreads, we've had all of those different types of presentation. They're all available via the previous webinar section. We have online courses when it comes to introduction options, all of those on-demand webcasts, as I said. But the very first thing that you might want to go to is some of those calculators and tools that I touched on before. If you're wanting to have a calculator that will start helping you in being able to price options or getting theoretical price of options, the easiest way is to launch what we call the margin estimator. And it's a theoretical options price tool that will help you in being able to understand options pricing for yourselves in the marketplace. That would be one of the key tools when I'm starting out, is using that to be able to get theoretical pricing from the options market itself. Another place that we update our theoretical prices at any particular point in time is under markets, trade our derivatives market. And you can see here derivatives market prices. This will give you, and obviously the market's closed at the moment, so that doesn't really help us too much. But if we wanted to get an options price on a particular stock, let's say it was a BHP option, we can simply select BHP and it will bring up all of the different options that are available over BHP itself. And you can quickly then tell where the prevailing market is trading, and it's all going to be zeros at the moment because obviously the market is closed. But if you wanted to get an idea of what the actual theoretical price of that option is, we can see here that all of these options have stars alongside them here because the market's closed at the moment. That is the theoretical price of the option. We update that 4 times a day on the ASX. So about every hour, an hour and a half of the trading day, that theoretical price will update and it will give you whereabouts that option is valued from an ASX perspective. just going to answer a couple of questions before we jump onto other parts of the website. So feel free to, if there's another part of the ASX website you want me to touch on, just send it through Q&A. I'm just going to answer a couple of questions that we have. Question come through is around those ASX 200 index options. Can trade options when my portfolio is 100,000, while my portfolio is on today is 25,000. Can I sell 200 options with ASX? So one of the things here I'd suggest is getting a really good understanding of what each of those individual options contract is worth. So at 100,000, each particular options contract would be about $57,000 would be the value of each one of those options contracts. So I wouldn't be selling 200 options contracts. It would just be the two that I'll be transacting there. But we do have some tools and calculators that can actually help you in being able to determine how many options that you might actually want to be doing if it was obviously a put protection transaction that you wanted. So you just go to analysis tools under that investors section. And the analysis tools have a whole bunch of different tools that are available to us, whether you like advanced charting tools, that could be something that interests you as traders in the marketplace. They're available via that section there as well. But we also have calculators that are available via that section too. So we have analysis tools and calculators that can really help people be able to calculate options values in the marketplace. So we go to those investments, tools and resources. Bear with me, the slide's taking a little while to load up on my screen. Just didn't pop up for us. Sorry about that. Just didn't pop up. Let me try just another quick way here. So one of the things here you can see is around portfolio protection. I'll actually download a PDF and a link to a calculator that will give you the exact amount of options that you should be purchasing for the equivalent of that index options, for instance. Another good tool that I think someone was talking about before was the early exercise calculator. We can see here that it will actually download an Excel spreadsheet, which gives you some understanding of when someone would exercise and when they wouldn't. So a couple of little tools that could help you when you're starting out in the options market. Just let me bring up the Q&A section again. Someone's asked, where can we buy options without a broker? Unfortunately, you have to use a broker. All ASX transactions need to go through a broker, so you do need to do that via broker themselves. If you're unsure as to what broker you might want to be using in the marketplace, I would suggest going to the Find a Broker page on the ASX website. Just close out of that section there. And we can see here investors and then find a broker advisor, and it will give you an understanding of the brokers that offer options for you in the marketplace itself. So that's on the ASX website there. WA follows Eastern State time for share market closing. The West Australian timing. Obviously, at this time of year, it's 3 hours difference, Christina. So the Australian market runs off of the Eastern State timing. So it opens 3 hours earlier, WA time, at our daylight savings time over here, and closes 3 hours 3 hours earlier over there. So your brokers over in WA are getting up nice and early in the morning, but at least I'm sure they can probably get to the beach a little bit earlier in the afternoon. Are there options for any ETFs so you can purchase the underlying shares? At this stage, Ash, yes, there's the one option over an ETF, which is over the State Street ASX 200 ETF. We're currently in negotiations to launch some new ETFs, hopefully in the next couple of months, over NASDAQ, S&P 500, and also global shares. So keep an eye out. There should be some more ETF options available for investors coming forward. On the trading screen, is it giving you the option price per share or per contract? And it's on a per share basis when you see it on screen. So always multiply it by that 100 shares. So if you've been quoted something as an option premium of 30 cents, it isn't 30 cents for all 100 shares, David. You multiply that 30 cents by 100. And obviously in that case, you're going to be trading $30 for that particular option. Can you demonstrate how the launch, the margin estimator works? I might touch, come back on that. What about the range of prices on offer for an option contract? And the broker will surely set the prices too high for reasonable profit. So options markets are a capital market. Your broker doesn't set the price. The market sets the price. But to ensure that you can buy and sell options, market makers are obligated by us at ASX. We had a really good course on how market makers price options in the market. I'd suggest definitely going through to that course that we did recently around market making, and you can get lots of details around that. Just let me get back to that margin estimator and show you how you launch it. So we're back into that options knowledge hub again. We scroll down until we get to that options margin estimator. And all we have to do is launch the margin estimator, and it just comes up as an embedded screen within our pages themselves. Looks not too descriptive. It's quite a simple screen itself, but which stock are you trading? So let's say it was the index. So you would type XJO and we find the security itself. And what it will do is it bring up all of those options that are available for us to be able to trade in XJO. And all we have to do is simply select the options that we wanted to be looking at. So let's say it was a 7,000 strike option. I'm just going to use one here. 7,300 is where the stock's trading at the moment. It's a call option. So straight away, we're getting the options theoretical price calculator here. We can see that the volatility of that particular option was at 22%. The interest rate that's been applied is 3.35, 7,000 strike price. And it's telling us that option's currently worth $329 or 329.6 points. So that would be worth $3,290 for each options contract. If we wanted to see, what if the market become more volatile on this particular option? Let's say we change that to a 40% volatility level as opposed to a 21% volatility level. We can all of a sudden, via the calculation tool, be able to start getting an understanding of what an increase in volatility will have to our particular options price. So we've obviously gone from a 329 point price option to a 335 price point priced option as a result of that movement in volatility, and that option itself gives us an understanding of how things might move over time. So index, obviously you don't have dividends that are impacting on indices. So let's clear that one again, and we'll go back and let's do an individual stock. For instance, we'll go to BHP. One of the nice things about this tool is for free, you're actually given in BHP, what is the next two expected dividends on BHP itself. So let's go to this one here. 39.50, confirm that option, and it gets us to the price calculator. So what the options market's telling us that on the 2nd of March this year, we're expecting a $1.36 dividend from BHP. And on the 7th of September, we're expecting a $1.67 dividend from BHP. What if it wasn't going to be 138? We can actually, if we think BHP is going to pay a higher dividend, even though it may not be expected by the market, let's say they paid $2, we can actually update our pricing and the options margin calculator to be actually able to give us an understanding, well, how much will that actually impact the options price? We can see this as an $8.80 option at this particular point in time. What if it was a $2 dividend? And it's telling it would actually go to $8.80.7. So we know that in this case, it's already been embedded in the options price. It would allow you to change volatility levels as well. Just a quick tool to help you be able to obviously calculate margins and the like. Theoretical prices. How does the ASX calculate the theoretical price? Do they use Black and Scholes model or binomial model? So really, really good question. It's quite theoretical. For those of you that don't understand options and the theory behind them, there's generally two pricing models for thought. It depends on what type of option is to what model we use at ASX. American style options, because of the early exercise nature embedded within them, Black and Scholes doesn't handle dividends too well. So for American style options, ASX uses the binomial model. But for European style options, we use the Black and Scholes model because dividends aren't going to impact on those European style options because there's no ability to adjust. The interest rate and volatility, the levels that we use are already on that screen there for you. So the levels that we have determined of those volatility levels and the interest rates, I would never change the interest rate. Volatility is the one that I can that I'd always change, but volatility in that case, we're giving you the level at what we've priced that particular option and what the volatility of that series is. So always use that one. Good question there. I'm going to quickly jump back to the presentation itself, just conscious of time, and it's popped over to 8 o'clock. I'm just going to wrap things up and then stick around for lots more questions if people do have them. Just waiting for it to pop back for yourselves. So we've kind of gone through some of those pages on the ASX website, whether it be online courses, those past webinar recordings. We expect to have a trading game up and running in May, those charting tools or even calculators. If you want to have a quick shortcut that you want to go into your browser, it's asx.com.au/options. That will get you straight to the page itself. We haven't set the actual next masterclass as yet. We're still working with our broker counterparts. We're going to be inviting them to participate in some of our sessions as well. So we expect to be able to release what that next session will be, and we'll email you all what that session will be, but it's expected to be towards the end of March. We're expecting this year to have a session every month as opposed to every second month like it was last year. Thank you all for your time this evening. For those of you that are listening online and listening to the recording, if you are wanting to ask questions of myself and the team at ASX, send an email to options@asx.com.au. On behalf of ASX, thank you again for your time. My name's Graham O'Brien, but for those of you online, I'm going to stick around and answer a few more questions now. Thank you again. So a couple of questions that came up at the very, very beginning that I'm going to touch on for Paul. So he was talking about his online learning, and they all start with being a taker of a long call, rarely a long put. And after that, it seems regular traders never use a long call or long put, implying poor outcomes, becoming in essence a net rider of multi-leg strategies. Your thoughts on this, please. Generally, why we always start out with long call and long put is anyone who's starting out in options markets has to understand risk first, Paul. And the most important thing is starting out with a predetermined maximum loss level. And at least by taking a call and taking a put or buying a put, you know your predetermined maximum loss when you're trading in an options market. The number two trading strategy in the options market is buying a long put. We rarely see buying a long call because often traders use leverage via other means. So I might go and buy a CFD, for instance, that has a much significantly higher risk profile than a long call, but it's just the way that investors have learned to use options here in Australia. But definitely the second most popular trading strategy today is long puts. The most popular trading strategy, surprisingly, is selling call options. But most importantly, it's selling call options over stock that they own. So it's about generating income streams. And I wouldn't confuse retail investors to institutional investors. Institutional investors are often net riders of options, but retail investors are generally net buyers of options, apart from selling call options over stock that they own. You've gone through the find a broker advisor. None seem to support beginner option trades. No tools, no means to practice. I would touch base with us tomorrow, Paul. Just send through your details. I'll have a chat. There are definitely brokers that are out there that actively provide help when it comes to options markets, and many of them are online and beginners brokers as well. So I'm surprised that you're finding that. That out there. Definitely there are people that are offering options and happy to take you on the education journey. So we might touch base on that one personally tomorrow. So shoot through your details, I'll give you a call. If the company goes bankrupt, what happens if I am a seller of a put option? If you are a seller of a put option, you have to pay cash to someone for a stock that you're never actually going to own. Unfortunately, that's the risk of selling put options, is that you're going to have to pay money for someone who are going to sell you a stock that you're never actually going to go in because that company's gone bankrupt. It's definitely one of the risks of selling puts. Most of the brokers don't support. I would say pretty much all of the brokers that are direct brokers of ASX offer options transactions. If you go to that find a broker page on the ASX website, they're available. But if you wanted to, I think that was ASF, shoot me through a note and I'm happy to have a chat online tomorrow. Does ASX offer courses on futures? We do have one online course on futures. However, futures are a much higher risk proposition. Generally, retail investors aren't trading a huge amount of futures. However, it might be something we can definitely look into. I'm more than happy to run a course on futures in the future as well. I can see that David's raised his hand. David, the easiest way here is to actually jot it via the Q&A section. I'm happy to answer it. And thanks, Paul. I've got your email there. Let's discuss together tomorrow, but there's definitely plenty of those brokers out there. Keep those questions coming through. How does the ASX calculate volatility? It's actually a statistical measure, and it's done by standard deviations, and it determines what is the expected movement in an underlying share, determines what the historical volatility of that share will be. That's then used by market makers to help to predict, or the market to help to predict what the implied volatility or the future expectation of volatility will be on an option. It's actually a component that's built into the Black and Scholes model and the binomial model that helps you in being able to, with all other factors being inputted, you can actually get the volatility level out of it. So how does volatility risk affect options trading strategies? If you are long an option and volatility falls, you will see a fall in your options valuation. If you are short options and volatility increases, once again, there will be an increase, which will be a negative effect on your options themselves. So not only when you're buying options, are you taking a directional view, you're taking a volatility view as well. So when you buy options, you're expecting volatility to increase. Markets have become more volatile and hopefully premiums will increase as a result. But when you're selling options, you're taking a short volatility view and you want the markets to be more stable over the life of the option. There's definitely some really good, I kind of touched on that and the statistical reality of volatility in a more advanced option session, which was one of our last masterclasses. So if you wanted to have a look at that, it's the recording that's actually on that ASX webpage. And I've got Raj's email, so I'll touch base on that one tomorrow. My broker buys insurance. Will you be explaining the insurance on options? So generally, options are used as the insurance tool. So you're not buying insurance on the options themselves. You're using options for insurance. The best way is to buy put options over shares. That would be the easiest way to buy that protection. And we do have both an online course and a masterclass that's already been recorded on that exact topic. For a beginner, is it better to sell put options in shorter duration or longer duration? I would say regardless of whether it's a put or a call, whenever you're selling options, always shorter duration, not longer duration. You're obligating yourself for longer. So as a beginner, always think sell short, buy long. So when you're buying options, buy longer dated options. When you're selling options, sell shorter dated options. Doesn't matter whether it's a call or a put. Any online brokers or platforms trade combinations like credit spreads? Yes, they're available, David. You do just have to have a chat with that broker as to what's happened is there's design and distribution obligations on all brokers to ensure that the strategies that you're using are appropriate for your knowledge base. Those brokers will require you to prove that knowledge base before they'll provide access to some of the more complicated strategies. But as far as I'm aware, all of the brokers that offer options transactions allow you to do credit spreads. You just have to have that conversation with the broker. Get the impression IV ranking is most useful. Is that correct? And readily available. I know implied volatility, Paul, offer IV ranking. It can be important, but all it is giving you a ranking against other stocks in the market. You still need to have a view of what you think the implied volatility will be in the future, as opposed to its ranking against its peers today. So it's definitely something to take into account, but I would still be having your own view on whether you think the market will be more volatile in the future. Someone's asking about brokerage fees, American brokers to trade Australian market. Cost $1 to trade, which is 30% cheaper. I would look, Brendan, at how many options contracts you're going to be trading, because generally the American brokers trade $1 per contract, whereas Australian brokers have a flat fee on a trade as opposed to the contracts being traded. So depending on how many contracts you're trading, it could be that the Australian brokers could be cheaper because they're charging on a per trade basis as opposed to a per contract basis. So if you were trading 30 to 35 contracts in options, all of a sudden your American broker is going to be at the $30 to $35 mark, as opposed to the Australian broker at $30 to $5 mark. So I'd just have a look at how that pricing might work. I'm not saying that the American broker you shouldn't use. By all means, if you're trading a lot fewer contracts, could be a very good place to start. And yes, you're right. For those new to trading, starting cost is very important. So definitely look into the things behind it, that it's $1 per contract as opposed to trade with some of those brokers. So we've got someone who sells US puts, but obviously staying up late at night time, I'm gathering. Yes, you can do that. Although in Australia at this point in time, we only have options over Australian shares in the Australian market. We should shortly have options over the NASDAQ index via an ETF, and also the S&P 500, which could be similar to what you're trading over there, but we do not have options on the ASX over US individual stocks. Someone's asked, is there a tool where we can calculate daily theta time decay in options? I would definitely have a chat with your broker. There's tools. I use a thing at the ASX called Iris. Lots of your brokers use Iris as the back end of their platform, and it will actually be a column in the pricing tool for yourself. So ask your broker whether they have in their pricing tool theta, and it's definitely something that should be available to you. Brendan's asked, you need to trade a lot before getting experience. I think you need to learn a lot before getting that experience as well. So yes, it's not something that you would be an expert quickly. I would definitely be wanting to test out those trading strategies and always educate yourself as you're going along. I always start out small myself when I'm trading. I think it's the best way to learn. Someone's mentioned there's over approximately 90 companies, how to decide which company to go for. You need to have an opinion on whether you think that company's going up or down, and your conviction to which is the company you have the best, your best thought on which direction it would move. So you need to have a view on the company before you can actually transact that option, for sure. Joshua's asked, what's the difference between a CFD and an option? I think the easiest way to explain that, Joshua, is both maybe over an underlying share, but when you're buying an option, the most you can ever lose is what you're outlaying. When you're purchasing a CFD, you can lose multiples of what you initially outlay in that CFD itself. So it can be the case when you're buying options that you have a predetermined maximum risk. With CFDs, the market can move significantly against you, and you can lose multiples of what you initially outlay. On the flip side, you can make multiples and multiples of what you initially outlay. So the risk can be higher, but the reward can be higher as well. Short duration for selling options. How many months is considered short? I'd say you need to be 3 months or less, T. short, 3 months or less. I would never start thinking about selling options longer than 3 months. And if you're going long and buying long, anything longer than 3 months, on the other side of that. Brendan's asking, what do you think about the poor man's covered calls as a starter technique? It might be the poor man's, but it's the most popular trading strategy we see. You just have to have the right market environment. So obviously the last couple of months have been a really poor environment for covered calls. So look at when you think the market's going to be starting to move sideways, and it's a really good start to getting used to options trading. Great. Not many more questions coming through. Thank you all very much for your time this evening. As I said before, if you do have more questions, shoot them through to options@asx.com.au. And I've got a couple of your email addresses. I'll leave this open for another 5 minutes. If people do want me to reach out via email tomorrow, just jot your email into that Q&A section. More than happy to drop you an email and start a conversation up. But thank you all very much again for your time this evening on behalf of ASX. Hope you have a really good night. Thank you.